What's up, everyone? Let's talk buffers. If you want, you'll probably notice you probably had some cameras that do something like this. And if you want it to do something like this, stick around, because I got 8 tips, tricks, and hacks to make sure you kind of don't run out of a buffer. There's a lot of settings you can put in your camera to make sure that you never hit that boundary where the camera just locks up. It just gives up on you. Some people just want to buy a new camera. They think that's the solution, but guess what? Sony a7R 4, 61 megapixels, it has the same limitation if you don't set it up correctly or if you get a little greedy. So let's get in these. First two are pretty easy to solve. Then we start getting into a little bit more nuances of things. So first off, you want a somewhat fast SD card. So you want to look at this SD card, and some of these SD1, SD2, some are 4 and 5 times faster. So some of these, you want to look at the write speed, and I'll put a link down below at some of the faster cards. They are more expensive, but you can get a smaller card, and hopefully that smaller card won't be quite as expensive, and you can just use that smaller card when you don't want to miss that moment. You know, you're at that moment where you got to get the photo, pop it in, and you can just use an average card, because these cards nowadays for these cameras are pretty cost fit. You know, they're fairly affordable, but the higher end ones are kind of outrageous. Get a smaller one when you need it. Second part, you'll notice the second tip, it's obvious, but feathering the trigger, feathering the shutter button. People get excited, they just hammer on, and they take useless photos of a camera, of an animal's back. You know, no eye contact, it's a no picture in my mind. I've done it, it just happens. You just wanna capture every moment and just go with it. So it's the thing, you get into a mode where you realize and you can kind of listen to the camera work. Even in silent mode, you'll see the images flick by. You'll know you're coming to the end of your buffer. So one thing is just, if you just get off it for a sec, get it back on, it will kind of regain. So the worst thing you want to do is just lock up the camera and just hammer down. And once it hits that point to where it locks up and it's got nothing in the buffer, and it freezes up the camera and it takes you longer to do anything. So ideally you want to keep that steady stream. You want to keep, 80% of your camera buffer full, and then you just want it continuously writing to your card. So you got to kind of back off a little bit, just back off, just let it, and you'll get to the point where you won't even have to look at how many JPEGs are left in the buffer on some of these, because it will say up at the top right on the cameras, and you'll just know. And so that's one of the things when you're working in the field, you're doing something, you're already looking at aperture, you're looking at ISO, you're looking at the light, the composition, you're looking at the animal, you're looking at the backdrop behind the animal. You don't have really that much time to look at how much JPEG buffer space you have. So I just use the listening of the camera to kind of tune in. Oh, better get off it. It's a no shot anyway. And then boom, you can kind of continuously shoot. So number three, now we start getting into the better stuff. This is continuous shooting speeds. You got high, medium, and low. So this camera will run 15 frames a second, but it burns through its buffer. So you gotta know what you wanna capture. If you're capturing diving birds in that moment, yes, throw everything at it. Highest continuous shooting speed on high, everything. But if you have deer, antelope, something slower, you can go to medium or slow, and that greatly increases your chance that you're not gonna blow up your buffer. You're not gonna lock it up. And so that's really, really good. That's an option that, again, you lock up your buffer, your camera just freezes up. There's nothing much you can do. You wanna avoid that at all costs. Many times I just go to medium speed or low speed. If it's a really kind of entry level camera, I'd rather just go with that than risk the other thing. So yeah. So number four, JPEG and RAW. So a lot of people will just shoot what's on the camera. You know, they don't really go in. JPEG is huge and costly to your camera and RAW. I should say RAW is hugely costly. JPEG, it's those two combined, it's doing twice the work. So it's saving two images internally and then to your SD card. So I know a fair amount of wildlife photographers that just shoot JPEG. There's some compromises there. You're gonna get 80, 90% of the image quality. Really don't notice it all that much. I shoot JPEG exclusively in wildlife. If it's studio work or something, you know, okay, you can go up to raw. Or if you're shooting landscape and you really wanna make it work. But a lot of wildlife photographers, when they're shooting, they'll shoot JPEG exclusive because they're going through 5 and 10,000 images. You know, they're just going through it. Now, RAW on this 61 megapixel resolution camera is over 100 megapixels for a RAW image, 100, 110, 120. So 10 photos, you're over a gig. So that's one of the things. And it plugs up the buffer very fast, this as well. So worst case settings, I had this on high and I had JPEG and RAW, and you can see it only kind of probably got 5 or 6 images out of that. When I backed off, got rid of the RAW, and I changed some other things, I could stream it out and kind of hammer that. So number 5, if you own a full frame camera, like a Sony, Canon, Nikon, you call it crop mode. So a lot of these cameras have crop mode. A lot of times I shoot in crop mode because a 600 mil lens becomes a 900 mil lens. But the other added benefit is my JPEG buffer goes up because the camera goes from 61 megapixels down to 26. 26 is plenty for me and what I do. And if I get an exposure, I'm happy because I got plenty of resolution at 26 megapixels. And the buffer goes up, it like doubles. And so, yes. So if you want to go to number 6, the tip trick for number 6 is, guess what? You might not have a full frame camera that you can do this with. You can do in crop mode, but you can change the image size and resolution in your camera. So going from 24 megapixels, you can go down to, let's see, 16, 10, and 6 megapixels. I know people, oh, I can't do that. But you got to realize, when I first got into photography, average megapixels was 4. The high-end guys, the guys that were earning a living shooting magazines, were 6. And they're creating beautiful, awesome work, just plain awesome work. So we have 4 times the starting resolution. And if you really need to capture that moment, you can make compromises that way. Just go down resolution. See if that helps alleviate the buffer. Yeah. And number 7, image quality. So number 7, image quality. A lot of cameras, like the Olympus, other cameras have a super fine, medium, and low. And here's the situation, and it goes back to resolution quality. It's not all linear, meaning if we double the data that we capture, we double the image quality. It doesn't work that way. So you sometimes have to use 4 times, 6 times, 8 times. So think of this, resolutions on screens, TV. We had 1080p TV or 1K, and we went to 4K. But before 1K, we had actually 480p. And when we went from 480p to 1080p, you can notice it. It's like, oh yeah, I can see that, because our eyes could pick up that change. But when we went from 1080p to 4K, it was like, yeah, it looks a little sharper. Yeah, you can kind of tell. But now we're going 4K to 8K, and it's very difficult. There's a percent, there's what our eyes can pick up as far as quality of data and the minute differences. So going from 26 megapixels or 61 to 26, I really can't tell the difference unless I zoom in. And going from a low, medium, high quality, hard to tell. But the data, the amount of data you capture, to notice that physically with your eyes is astronomically, it goes up not by a double or triple, quadruple and more. So just know that you can go to a medium quality and be pretty happy with the results. And in the Sigma Quattro cameras, I would go to a medium quality, and the buffer would go way up as far as what I'm able to capture and how many JPEGs and that I could do. So this leads us to number 8, the biggest hack, the one I really like, video. 24 frames a second, man. You could stream your video. You could do it 24 frames a second. And guess what? 4K video is 8.3 megapixels. Started out with 4 in the industry that I remember, 6 for a lot of pros. Now we got 8. And you can just stream it, keep going. And all these cameras, Sony, Canon, Olympus all have still grabs. So take your video, work it out if you don't want to miss that moment, and then later go in and grab. You can go into the application and say grab still, and then save it as a JPEG. Boom, you're done. It's like the greatest hack. The greatest hack that I like. And the image quality for an 8x10, 13x19 is outstanding. If you process it right, that's a whole nother video, but I think you guys would be happy with it. That's it, guys. Eight tips, eight tricks. See if this helps. Don't need to buy a new camera. Just work with it, figure out what's going on, and improvise, adapt, and overcome. If you like this stuff, subscribe, and I will see you next week.